The epistle reading this morning is from the first chapter of the Revelation to John. We're picking up the narrative in the second part of verse 4, what we call 4b. And just a few words of introduction to what this book is all about. You might recall last Sunday, we looked at a text from Gospel of Mark in which Jesus was talking about the end things. And I was explaining that what we call apocalyptic literature comes out of times of crisis. And that particular text in Mark was written 30 to 40 years after Jesus' death and resurrection, at the time when Jerusalem was in the process of being destroyed by Rome. Well, we have a similar situation today in the book of Revelation. You'll note in your few Bibles it says the Revelation to John. This is a different John than the John who wrote the Gospel of John. Sometimes this John is called John of Patmos or John the Divine. Even in New York City, you know, there's a great big huge Episcopal cathedral there on the Upper West Side called St. John the Divine. It's been under construction for over 100 years and it's still not done. But anyway, this particular John is writing at a time in which the early church is also at a point of crisis. The early Christians are experiencing persecution by the Romans, and so you'll see that a lot of the kind of crisis language that he uses here makes sense in that context. So let's listen to God's word. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings on earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him. Everyone who pierced him and all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Our gospel reading this morning is from the 18th chapter of the Gospel according to a different John. We're picking up the narrative in verse 33. This is a familiar scene to many. It is Jesus on trial before Pilate. Pilate entered the praetorium again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingship is not of this world. If my kingship were of this world, my servants would fight that I might not be handed over to the Jews. But my kingship is not from the world." Pilate said to him, "So, you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." And this is the word of the Lord. As I mentioned earlier, today we bring the Christian year to a conclusion. In the church's calendar, Christ the King, or Reign of Christ Sunday, is, now I'm speaking with hyperbole here, it's sort of like the Super Bowl trophy,
or the Final Four in college basketball, or the last game of the World Series. This is what everything has been moving toward. In baseball, for instance, there is spring training and then the opening pitch of the season, the first games in the spring, the long summer, the end of your stretch, and then the playoffs, and then it all leads, at least for two final teams, to the World Series. Well, in a similar way, in the Christian year, it begins with Advent, which is preparation for the birth of Jesus. And then the celebration of his birth at Christmas, and then his appearances, first to the wise men, then at the wedding, and then in the transfiguration at Epiphany. And then he sets his face toward Jerusalem, and we are plunged into the days of Lent. And that entails, of course, suffering and sacrifice and self-denial, ultimately his betrayal and his death during Holy Week. And then we're confronted with the silence of Holy Week, and specifically Holy Saturday. But then the miracle of resurrection at Easter and the prayer over 50 days to the coming of the Spirit at Pentecost. And then the church moves through what we call ordinary time or the season of Pentecost, and we're called to reflect on the kingdom of God in everyday life. But all of it moving toward a conclusion. You can see it in the imagery in the book of Revelation this morning, or in the way, if you take a look at our black hymnal, part of it, you'll see that it's ordered to coincide with the liturgical year. Death and eternal life, the union of the saints, the symbolic return and reign of the Lord, the completion of the creation, what the New Testament writers call the city of God. And Christ the King Sunday is all about the lordship of Christ. In other words, rather than the words of the Revelation of John, he is the ruler of the kings of the earth. And yet there's a clear distinction in this passage from the Gospel of John between the rule or reign of the leaders on the one hand and of God's vision on the other. Jesus says, "My kingdom is not of this world." Jesus did come upon the earth to establish a kingdom. It's just not what many were expecting. So on this last Sunday of the church year, the reign of Christ, we're challenged ponder both issues, divine and human, in terms of power and leadership. I want you to ask yourself this morning, do our visions of divine power shape our images of human power and authority? Or do our visions and practices of human power shape how we view God? Do we use our visions of God as justifications for our own power relationships, or our own power over others? As I was thinking about these questions this week, I was thinking to myself that I suspect that our understandings of the relationship of divine and human power are really, if we're honest with ourselves, one and the same. You see, for many, if not most people, as they relate to power relationships, things like gender and sexuality and class and political policy and so on, we tend to kind of meld these two things together. But in our humanity, in our hunger for power, we so often get it wrong. Consider, for example, how often the cross has become a symbol of might rather than a symbol of peace. Christianity, you'll recall, came about as a small group of powerless people in the eastern provinces of the Roman Empire. But by the time of Constantine in the 4th century, the church had become integrated into the social system of the same empire that had persecuted it. The Christians who had been persecuted became the persecutors. Constantine became the righteous king through whom God's reign would be established on earth. Then in medieval times, emperors throughout Europe considered themselves to be kings by divine right, representing, as they would say, the fatherhood of God on earth. How many wars have been fought because of that way of thinking? Fought in the name of God with shouts from both sides that God is on our side. Let's think about these things in terms of our gospel reading this morning. Remember that Jesus is brought before Pilate in what was called the Praetorium, which was sort of like a courtroom. The accusation against him is that he's claiming to be a king. In other words, he's claiming to be like the Roman ruler, Caesar. He stands there, this peasant figure, hands tied behind his back, bruised and bleeding from the abuse of his captors. What is all the fuss about? Pilate says to himself. Can you, poor creature that you are, really be a king? What kind of a threat can you possibly pose to imperial Rome? Then a lot of people ask, are you the king of the Jews? And Jesus answers boldly, are you asking, or is it what you've been told about me? Pilate is taken aback. Doesn't this man know his power? Pilate says, or asks, do I look like a Jew? Then back to the task at hand, Pilate says, it's your own people who have handed you over to me. You must have done something to deserve this treatment. What is it that you have done? And Jesus continues saying, my kingdom is not of this world. And it's true. Jesus' kingdom is not of this world. But think about who Pilate is. He is Caesar's surrogate in this backward eastern Mediterranean province of the Roman Empire. But nevertheless, he's a person of power and of wealth and of prestige. And so looking at this poor peasant Jesus, thinking of him as a king is really impossible. Pilate, too, is a politician. He understands authority. He has wealth, he has power. So he says, that means that you're sort of a king after all. He says to Jesus, he wants a yes or no answer, but that's not what he gets. Jesus explains, I would not choose the title king for myself, for to be a king, as you know, it is not my role. My mission, rather, is to be a witness, not a king. My subjects are those who follow what I say. Those few words overturn every concept of kingship and power that one can imagine. Do they raise questions in your mind as they do mine? In what sense is Jesus a king? In what sense is he Lord of the events of our lives? Who is Jesus for us? Those are the questions that arise as we think about this day in the liturgical calendar, Christ the King. John, the divine John of Patmos, in that letter that he wrote titled The Revelation, gives us a long list of descriptions for who Jesus is for him. And these are the words he uses. He is the one who is, who was, who is to come, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the ruler of the kings of the earth, the one who loves us, the one who has freed us from our sins, the Alpha and the Omega. Can you hear in these descriptive names of Jesus the incredible excitement that John has for his faith in this person? So often, our image of Jesus is confined mainly to the comfortable, what we're comfortable with. For example, for many, the image that we have from our childhood Sunday school is the image of a gentle Jesus. Take a look at this stained glass window right over here, or the one in the back. Gentle Jesus with the children hanging on to his knees, right there. That is the picture many of us grew up with in Sunday school, is the warm and comforting image of Christ, is the view of Jesus that takes us immediately back to our childhoods. Personally, I can see myself, and perhaps you can too, kneeling at your bedside and your hands folded, rattling off the prayer that your parents may have taught you. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep, and if I die before I wake, I pray. Remember that piece of real scare the heck out of me. It's a wonderful image, but it doesn't necessarily get us up off our knees and acting on what we believe. For many, Jesus is the good shepherd, and that's the stained glass window in the back. Even in our urban society, where shepherds are nowhere to be found, we take comfort in that beautiful image. It's the primary reason that the 23rd Psalm is always read at funerals. We see ourselves out in the fields, following after Jesus, not here in the world. He's here to comfort, to guide, to lead, to heal our wounds, to protect us from danger. Perhaps for us, Jesus is our personal therapist. We bring all of our problems to Jesus. We come in our neediness with our long list of woes. We expect that Jesus will make our lives easy and comfortable. It's important, of course, to pray for our needs and needs of others, but it's also important that it should inspire and motivate us to action. We need to get up off our knees and do something about ourselves and about the state of the world. Then perhaps the right image for Jesus would be that of radical reformer. I don't see that on any of the stained glass windows. If we want to change the world to make it a better place, to put an end to violence and war, then Jesus the Reformer is the one we need to follow. We all want an end to war and violence. And many of us would fight to make it happen. That may seem kind of a 60s kind of role for Jesus. Yet in many ways, when we look at the New Testament, it's rather traditional. At least some of the disciples seem often to be viewing Jesus in that traditional role of Messiah. They followed Jesus because in their messianic fervor they were convinced that Jesus would overthrow the Roman rulers and become the political liberator that they so longed for. They believed that God had sent Jesus to save the Jewish nation. They looked for a Messiah who would restore the kingdom of Israel. He would conquer the enemies of Israel and become the ruler of an earthly kingdom. That was certainly the kind of kingship that Pilate's question to Jesus reflected. The problem, however, is that Jesus is all of those things, but so much more. When we limit who Jesus is, we lose the capacity to see God as other than a resource for our own personal needs. We lose our vision that will propel us into the breaking in of God's kingdom in this world. We lose sight of the kingship of Jesus. We lose sight of the fact that we have a vocation, a calling, and that we have a Lord to serve, and that we have a kingdom to build right here. And you know, all of us are on that journey, whether we're aware of it or not. Ask yourself, how do people come to know that we are Christians? How do they know that we serve this King named Jesus? To know who Jesus is in our lives should inspire and motivate us to action. Now, I'm not advocating that you go out two by two into the community, collaring unsuspecting victims and dragging them back into the church, although that's actually a pretty humorous thing to think about. The point is, if our faith doesn't motivate us to action, then we're lacking something. If the suffering around us numbs us, then we'll be unable to take responsibility for it. Being Christian, following Jesus, being forgiven, having eternal life are not so much about what affects us, but how we live as servants of God and how we affect the lives of others. So, friends, I'll end this morning by simply saying, or asking, that God might grant that. that the hubris that divides us from one another may be overcome, and that we might be united under the gentle and glorious rule of our Lord Jesus Christ, the one whom we're called by to loving service in the world on behalf of Him. May we proclaim that Christ indeed is King in our lives, and may it spur us on to living our lives for Christ and for those around us. Let us pray. O Lord our God, you called us to service. You were a servant, always putting the needs of others before your own, always breaking down the barriers between cliques and groups, race and clan, calling us to enlarge our understanding, not only of the diversity of our human condition, but the expansiveness of your love and grace. Lord, help us as a church and as individuals to live that example out. We ask it in your name. Amen.